Recorded Books and One Click Digital present After Dead, What Came Next in the World of Sookie Stackhouse by Charlaine Harris, narrated by Johanna Parker.
Coda material. After I began writing the final novel in the Sookie Stackhouse series, I was deluged by questions from readers who all wanted to know the same thing: how to find out what happened to a score of characters who couldn't make an appearance in the last book. It was obvious I couldn't fit all of the people in Bon Temps and its environs into Dead Ever After. So, in the interest of satisfying the readers who've been following Sookie's adventures for years, I herewith present my coda to the books that have dominated my professional life for over a decade. In alphabetical order. The Ancient Pythoness continues to be cared for by the vampires of Rhodes. The donors from the donor bureau who are sent to her have to be carefully briefed because giving her blood is terrifying and definitely unsexy. Greg and Christy Aubert continue to work at Greg's insurance agency, Pelican State. Greg, a natural witch, struggled with using his innate power to improve his business after he almost ran all the other insurance agents in Bon Temps into the ground. He underwent an intervention, telling the psychologist he was an alcoholic, to change his behavior. Not too surprisingly, the treatment didn't work too well. Greg finally managed to impress Greg Jr., who was watching from the garage one day when his dad reinflated a tire by pointing his finger at it. Lindsay, their daughter, sowed her wild oats and then settled down to teach tap and jazz to little girls in Clarice. She married a farmer. Connie Babcock, the deceitful secretary at Hervaux and Son, was not able to get a comparable job after she was fired. She ended up working as a guard at a correctional facility. The Ballinger family, Doak, Mindy, Bonnie, and Mason, are living happily in Mooney, Texas. Doak got laid off for a while, but he was called back to work before things got too tight. Mindy got a job working as a secretary at the high school, and she really enjoyed it. Mason had nightmares about the day of his uncle's wedding, but his parents talked to him a lot and sent him to a counselor, and he got through it. He became a manager at a mattress factory. Bonnie didn't remember that awful day. The wedding was picketed by protesters, but she became an activist for various social causes later in life. She was also the best veterinarian in West Texas. Christian Baruch was accused of unprofessional behavior at a meeting of the Vampire Hoteliers Association. He was never seen again. Batania and Clovache, the Britlingens. The Britlingen Collective continues its business of providing protection to whoever can pay for it in several worlds. Batania thinks Clovache is the best partner she's ever had, and they've had many adventures in many strange situations. So far, they've come out alive. Isabel Beaumont, Dallas vampire, racked up an impressive body count among the rebels responsible for killing her king, Stan. She still lives in Dallas and has become Joseph Velasquez's right hand. She never dates humans. Alcee and Barbara Beck went away for a vacation in Hawaii after the events of Dead Ever After. They returned after 2 weeks with some very interesting underwear and big smiles on their faces. Andy and Hallie Belfleur welcomed their daughter, Caroline, 2 months after the events of Dead Ever After. Caroline was born with a heart defect, but after some surgery, she lived a relatively normal life for many years. They had 2 more children, sons, Jared and Clayton. Caroline's heart defect unexpectedly caused complications when she was a senior in high school, and Andy and Hallie buried her in her cheerleader uniform. Jared and Clayton both became lawyers, like their aunt, Portia Belfleur Vick. Terry and Jimmy Belfleur welcomed many litters of pups to their double wide, and 3 of the pups won prizes at Catahoula shows. 8 years after their marriage, the two died in a 2-car accident when they were returning from a grandchild's birthday party. Terry was sincerely mourned by Jimmy's children and grandchildren, and I gave a donation to the VA hospital in Shreveport in Terry's honor. It was earmarked for the treatment of prisoners of war. Bernard the Vampire, a great friend of Russell Edgington's, became an even better friend of Christopher Hauser, the Vampire King of Germany.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.